Is that water too hot?
That's Tabitha Stanton handling the rinse at a styling salon in Clifton, wondering if customers are going to get rinsed in a different way if street meters are leased.
Like, sometimes my clients run late because they don't have a place to park.
Parking's already at a premium along the Ludlow Business District. Shops here are sweating the impact of the higher rates and more tickets they believe a private company would bring. As the city's elected leaders balanced a new $368 million operating budget this afternoon, they did so with what you might call shadow money. Think of the new budget like a city parking meter. Unless you plug it with $21 million, your time will expire in March. That's when lawmakers will decide to either go with the manager's parking plan or craft a $21 million alternative.
Well, I mean, we would have to use casino revenue. I mean, that's a given. But I don't think that that's, you know, it's a new revenue source for the city.
Council has again patched here and there enough to keep the mounted patrol riding a while longer, enough to prop up public access television for one more year. But the parking controversy hangs over City Hall like an unpredictable party guest. Saying no leaves you in an immediate $21 million hole. The upfront money the city would get is tantalizing, and yet...
A very distasteful option is perhaps the lease parking. And if we don't get a better alternative, we'll have to hold our nose and go with it.
The talk around here goes something like, just a light rinse will do.
It might deter people from shopping in the area.
Cincinnati's controversy over control of its parking meters will now move to center stage before the end of the month.
Yeah, within the next 3 weeks now, council expects to receive details about leasing meters to a private firm. WLWTV's John London is live with what you can expect. Hi, John.
Well, Cherie, you can expect specifics on how enforcement hours could change. Free Sunday parking is also a very touchy topic that figures prominently in the neighborhoods and in the mayoral campaign.
Like time on a meter, the wait for specifics about the parking plan will soon expire. John Diebold says hallelujah.
I'm constantly getting complaints from customers about parking rates.
He's ready to become Mr. Scrutiny. As owner of Washington Platform, he has a vested interest in who sets rates and times for the city's 6,000 meters.
People know that if they come downtown at night for dinner, they have free parking at the meters, if not, if they don't want to park in the lots. Take that away on Sundays and evenings, I'm not sure how that's going to affect downtown.
They'll sure tell you inside Capitals, a longtime accessory and party supply mecca. Their message? Don't monkey with the meters.
It's really going to discourage customers from coming to town. And I'm sure the enforcement is going to be significant, so that makes it even worse.
The issue of leasing street meters to a private company is helping define this year's campaign for mayor. Democrat John Cranley chose Hyde Park Square today to propose a debate with Vice Mayor Qualls.
I think it'll hurt small businesses. It'll hurt Hyde Park Square and all of our small business districts. Roxanne believes it's a good thing for some reason. Let's have a debate and let people decide, you know, who they think has got the better argument.
Her campaign countered by proposing 5 debates. In a letter to Cranley, she states, few are served by a debate on a singular issue that you claim to oppose even before the actual proposal, including all the facts and details, are known. The city administration contends 2013 is the right time to modernize parking, upgrade districts, and create more customer-friendly meters. The unofficial debate's already underway.
It's going to be too expensive, and the city, I think, is going to feel a real backlash from it.
All right, and tonight the city manager's office here insists the new parking arrangement's not designed to be a short-term budget fix, but to position the city for an ongoing revenue stream. We are hearing that the specifics could be as ready as soon as 10 days from now. Reporting live at City Hall, John London, WLWT News 5.
All right, John, thanks for the update. By the way, the administration has said that if council rejects this leasing plan, it's going to have to close a $21 million budget gap. However, the manager's office confirming for us today that the city is now running a $9 million surplus, at least at the moment.
The changes could cost you every time you park.
Yeah, maybe even on weekends. WLWT News 5's John London talking to local business owners and shoppers tonight to see what they think about the parking possibilities.
In neighborhood districts like Mount Lookout, they're getting antsy about the plan to lease the city's 7,500 meters to a private company.
The rates tend to go up. The hours that they enforce parking tend to go up.
Thank you very much.
Inside Boardwalk Hobby Shop, affordable street parking is the lifeblood of business, 7 days a week.
We're open on Sundays, as a lot of the businesses are here, and it's kind of a bonus for people to be able to park for free in a neighborhood business district.
Specifics have yet to surface, but possibilities include annual rate increases, extending enforcement hours to 9 p.m., and eliminating free Sunday parking, which could affect churches like Knox Presbyterian, where some congregants now park for free along Michigan. At Zips, where they whisk an $8 lunch to your table with the efficiency of their signature miniature train, they want two things out of parking: high turnover and low rates.
I like the idea of it being enforced. I don't like the idea of it being raised.
Leasing to an out-of-state company such as Xerox Guggenheim would, by some estimates, produce an immediate $85 million for the city, a one-time windfall. The manager has stated the city won't do anything that drives business away or drives rates sky high.
Don't believe that. You're taking $85 million up front. That's not given out of the generosity of the heart out of a New York hedge fund.
Jim Alford, who owns Curabella Salon, says he's fed meters for customers at times, isn't sure what the impact might be on the Brandy Carters of his business. She drives in from Blue Ash for styling.
I don't know if I would stop coming here. I guess I'd have to see what the rates would be. Mm-hmm. Or maybe get dropped off down here.
The answer would be I would not stop coming here.
Lighthearted moments are few and far between on the idea of leasing meters for $85
million. If it gets diverted to the streetcar, I got a big issue with that.
And they won't have to plug the meter tonight because it's after 6 now, but community leaders from Hyde Park and Oakley will be in Mount Lookout in about an hour for a community meeting to hear from mayoral candidates and some council members about parking fears and facts. Yvette Simpson plans to tell them if this doesn't work out, they'll find some other way to plug a $21 million budget gap. Reporting live, John London, WWT News 5.
Selling the city's parking operations and enforcement to a private company. We have learned Cincinnati Council could vote as early as Monday to give that plan the green light despite public opposition. WLWT News 5's John London looking at which council members now very key that this decision has come down to. John?
Yeah, two, Mike, potentially, and you'll hear from both in a second. You'll also get a peek at some projections that relate to how vigorous parking violations at meters like this one might be enforced.
A vote on the parking plan that has much of Cincinnati in an anxious state of mind could be fast-tracked by Monday.
If the council members are prepared to vote, then there can be a vote as early as Monday.
As long as a fifth vote can be identified.
100% undecided. Yeah. Could go either way, honestly.
Or convinced on the merits by Monday.
Like many others, there's some additional information I'd like to be able to get my hands on.
Such as Guggenheim's voluminous response to the city's request for proposals. It projects a doubling of meter and enforcement revenue in the first year. Currently, the city takes in $3.7 million in parking meter money and $3.6 million in ticket enforcement. Guggenheim's projected take for 2014 is $8.5 million in meter money, $6.4 million in revenue from enforcement. No elected leader we asked today was clear on whether truck stop violations, double parking, or other non-meter violations would be enforced by the 40 new Xerox employees. The city confirms tonight Xerox will have that enforcement power, subject to rules and regs laid out by the city.
Aggressive enforcement and aggressive ticket writing.
The Cranley for Mayor campaign cites pages 41 and 42 in the Guggenheim response. Cameras can also be used to enforce double parking and a host of other parking violations. Cranley warns of drive-by ticketing.
Minimum a month. Let us fully vet this deal.
At Coffee Emporium today, Councilman Sittenfeld wants this issue on slow roast, not fast perk. The Cranley camp, poring over the minutiae of documents, says if it's passed, there'll be a referendum to overturn it. Monday appears to be in motion.
While decisions can be difficult, they should not be avoided.
And Vice Mayor Qualls, who's also running for mayor, says if there is no vote on Monday, she'll call a special session for the following week. So sometime between the 6th and the 16th, you can expect an up and down vote on this very controversial parking plan. Reporting live, John London, WLWT News 5.
All right, John, and of course, if the parking plan does not pass, the city manager has been warning us about those deep cuts and layoffs in order to balance the budget.
Leading the way, on air, online, and on the go. WLWT News 5 at 6 starts now.
New tonight at 6 o'clock, and a judge just put the brakes on that controversial plan to lease the city's parking operations. Good evening to you. I'm Cherie Palella.
And I'm Mike Dardis. Interesting developments today. Earlier, council passed the plan with a 5-4 vote. WLWT News 5's John London live now to explain what's going on and why the judge quickly stepped in. John.
Well, Mike, the parking plan survived council this afternoon, but now comes the court. Here's a copy of the lawsuit that was filed late this afternoon by several citizens. Judge Robert Winkler issuing a temporary restraining order that effectively prevents the city from implementing the plan they just approved. Today's debate wasn't as much about leasing the city's 5,700 meters, 1,900 of them downtown, as it was about counting to five. Satisfying Lori Quinlivan about dealing with deficits became paramount.
And I've gotten a lot of my questions answered. And I think in balance, this is a good deal for the city.
To get her to that point of support, a majority of council gave the city manager the freedom to scrap a future police recruit class if need be. That's a turnaround on recent policy. It comes as lawmakers grapple with future deficits once the one-and-done $92 million parking windfall is gone.
Unless we come up with an additional sustainable source of revenue, a large sustainable source, we're never going to be able to plug this hole.
The manager sizes the hole at $35.6 million next year if there's no parking plan, another $10.6 million the following year. But City Hall is still hearing furious dissent and distrust about who calls the shots on the meters.
You know that all of the communities are against this inside backroom deal.
Mayoral candidate John Cranley minced no words about why he supports a lawsuit to try to block the plan.
And there's plenty of ways. If they cancel the streetcar, if they use the casino money, if they use the parking meter revenue, there's plenty of ways they can balance this budget without having to lay off police and fire. And they shouldn't mess up the neighborhoods and try to use fear tactics to raise rates in parking meters and drive business and people out of the city.
All right, now tonight, City Solicitor John Kerp says the city faces legal challenges like this all the time, some of them serious, some of them frivolous. He does not think that a court will interfere with the city's parking plan ordinances, but this TRO states that the city, at least temporarily, can accept no payment or execute any lease pending a hearing in 10 days. Live at City Hall, John London, WLWT News 5.
Leading the way on air, online, and on the go. WLWT News 5 at 6 starts now.
Cincinnati's parking plan still in limbo. Good evening, everybody. I'm Mike Darda. Cherie is off on this Friday night. Council voted to lease all of the parking meters and garages to a private company, but a judge put on the brakes. Tonight, WLWT News 5's John London is live downtown with why it's tied up in this legal battle. John?
Well, Mike, the city has bonds to sign, and opponents of leasing meters like the one you will see here have signatures to collect. What they have in common is no time to waste, so they dashed from court to court today in full battle mode.
City attorneys were in hurry-up mode on the way into federal court. Their pipe dream was not even having to plug a meter if there could be a fast decision to dismiss.
Even 5 seconds without a temporary restraining order in place, the city's going to sign that lease. At that point, the city will argue that the case is moot.
But there was no fast federal kill shot. Judge Michael Barrett concluded he had no jurisdiction after all. He needed track shoes to keep up with the lawyers, going and coming. We've got a lot of this today.
I don't have time, so.
For both sides, there is a limited amount of time left on their respective meters.
This, of course, is a delay tactic.
The mayor, manager, and majority on council have a 60 to 90 day window to move bonds to the market. With a new July 1st budget cycle, the clock's ticking.
If this lawsuit holds us up for much longer, or if it's successful, the reality is the manager will have to lay off hundreds of city employees, including police officers and firefighters. That's what this suit could result in if it's successful.
For those mounting a petition campaign about parking, they're already 4 days behind in starting to gather signatures. Even as they scurried into Judge Winkler's court this afternoon, they were headed to the printer. They'll need 7,500 valid signatures by April 6th.
In a nutshell, this is really about whose government is it? Is it the people or is it six members of city council?
No one can really say with certainty how much time remains on the meter of this dispute, only that it's running out quickly.
The city needs to know the outcome of the case as soon as possible.
All right, and that could be by this time next Friday. I can tell you that so far the best line in this dispute has come from federal judge Michael Barrett today when he arrived in court and said, sorry, I'm late. I was looking for a parking spot. Live at the courthouse, John London, WWT News 5.
Some folks have to find the humor in all of this. Thank you, John. The hearing before Judge Robert Winkler is back on, set for 10 a.m. next Friday, 1 week from today. WLWT News 5, of course, will have that covered for you.
A huge controversy has parked itself right in front of these meters. Most of City Council has decided to lease them out over the next 30 years for $92 million to feed the deficit. But opposition fears that's going to leave you paying more to park and for longer hours. So they filed a restraining order, and now they're getting a petition started.
I have called, I have petitioned, I have emailed, and I get two responses from two offices, Mr. Sittefeld and Mr. Smitherman. That's it.
Frustrated Cincinnatians like Jim Kiefer made their way to Oakley Square. They're determined to do what they can to stop the parking deal.
I don't like giving away public assets.
Mark Fiss signed the petition after studying up on other cities that leased out parking. He says if customers have to pay more to park, including nighttime hours, it'll kill business.
We think that this is not only a bad plan for neighborhood business districts, but every resident in the city of Cincinnati.
This petition drive launch is intended to put a boot on the city ordinance. These folks spent their Sunday telling Cincinnatians they need to stand up to prevent council from leasing the city's parking for decades just to get an upfront budget windfall. These volunteers and politicians banded together all afternoon in a relentless effort.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Right.
They collected hundreds of signatures and said some people even registered to vote so they could join the petition. They want to overwhelmingly surpass the 7,500 signatures needed to add the issue to your ballot. Even that can only happen if the restraining order helps prevent council's emergency decision.
Six members of council took that away from the citizens of Cincinnati by passing this ordinance by emergency.
We talked with one of the council members who voted for leasing off the meters. Yvette Simpson calls it a necessary sacrifice.
We get to take an underutilized asset. We get to use it for our operating deficit, which is very real in the short term. But we also get to take a majority of the money and put it in places where we can grow our pie.
Simpson explains money will go to the pension fund, city projects, and most importantly, prevent layoffs.
Making cuts, right, to public services will almost certainly be detrimental to our neighborhoods and our business districts.
Members of council wanted this deal to go through without citizens to look at it. That's obvious.
Their goal is 20,000 signatures. This coming Friday, Judge Winkler will make his decision on the restraining order on this issue. At City Hall, I'm Laura Borchers, WLWT News 5.
A plan to privatize parking in Cincinnati and get that issue on the November ballot is now back in a courtroom today. WLWT News 5's Brian Hamrick was there as both sides made their cases. Brian.
Yeah, Mike, whether or not this goes on the ballot is now in the hands of a judge after the parking dispute goes from here at City Hall to the courtroom. The debate over parking.
All right, we're on the record.
Is now parked in front of a judge.
We want our right of referendum. We want this court to clearly declare and indicate to the city we have that right of referendum.
Kurt Hartman represents a group that wants to put the controversial parking plan on the ballot, all after a majority of council voted to lease out parking lots over the next 30 years for $92 million up front and $3 million a year.
Good morning, Your Honor.
In a back-and-forth court dispute, Terry Nestor, the attorney for the city, said that this was deemed an emergency order and immune to referendum.
The emergency is clear and described in the clause. It includes budget cuts, personnel layoffs, and reductions to city services across the city of Cincinnati.
But the argument isn't over there. Those who want the voters to decide say the emergency clause is irrelevant. Judge Winkler will consider both sides before making a ruling. Until then, those against a parking proposal continue with their own plan, collecting enough signatures to make sure they get this on the ballot if they do win.
I mean, in 4 days, we've collected 3,100 signatures towards this petition drive. We're going to keep collecting petitions until we hear otherwise.
Meanwhile, proponents contend the vote is already over.
We have 9 members of council elected by the people to make these decisions, and they voted. I don't know what else we can do in a representative democracy.
Now, Judge Winkler hopes to make his decision by March 28th, but there's no guarantees. He has a murder trial coming up next week.
Reporting live, Brian Hamrick, WLWT News 5.
Hey, Brian, thanks a lot. The city, by the way, hoping to get a decision in time to make adjustments for the budget.
The devices that carefully measure time now have a role in the future when it comes to interpreting the city charter.
Basically, Judge Winkler has vindicated the right of the people to vote.
Kurt Hartman is the attorney for six people who were against the controversial parking proposal.
Simply designating something as an emergency legislation does not create some magical inability of the people not to referendum the ordinance.
The case comes down to whether or not the people will get to vote on the parking ordinance that would give Cincinnati $92 million up front plus money every year to run the city's parking for several decades. The key legal component is that the ordinance was passed as an emergency. In Ohio law, those are not generally subject to the vote of the people. But in a 15-page opinion, Judge Robert Winkler ruled that it is in the Cincinnati Charter, writing, "The city's power to enact legislation is conferred by the city charter, not the Ohio Revised Code." He goes on to say, "The charter language is clear that it refers to all legislation passed by city council with no exceptions." Despite the ruling, the fight is not over yet.
We will vigorously go through the process of appeal.
The mayor and city manager spoke today saying if the ruling stands, it will be impossible for them to make the current budget. Cuts and layoffs are expected. But for now, time has not expired on the battle.
Leading the way, on air, online, and on the go. WLWT News 5 at 5 starts now.
A-plus day of pride for Cincinnati's new firefighters, but Plan B hovers over them like a storm cloud tonight. They and scores of older firefighters are facing possible layoffs unless the city figures a way out of its budget mess.
And good evening to you. I'm Cherie Polello. Mike Dardis has the night off. It really is the domino effect here of this parking plan sitting in neutral tonight without the money the city was expecting to get. Leaders are now looking at making some massive cuts. And in the case of firefighters, it's a double-edged sword tonight no matter which way they slash. WLWT News size John London is adding up what's really at stake tonight. John?
Well, for starters, Cherie, $12.1 million, that's what the city could possibly have to return or do without if any firefighter is laid off. But it goes way beyond federal grant money. The city would also lose what it celebrated just a few hours ago.
A proud ceremony bumps up against a hard reality. With 6 months of training behind them, 38 fire recruits are now part of a department that marks 160 years on opening day. But for how long?
When we talk about 350 layoffs, that's a number. But when you're here at an event like this, you look into the eyes of the people that this could affect, and it really makes you ponder what our priorities are.
People like Derek Hunt and his sister Damara, both pinned by their father, graduating on the same day. All of today's recruits were told to avoid commenting on the budget layoff situation, but there were fleeting references.
We were fortunate enough to receive a federal grant to pay for these firefighters.
$5.9 million sat on this stage at the Art Museum today, recruit class number 111. In May, number 112 comes with a grant value of $6.2 million. The federal string attached is that all $12 million plus might very well have to be repaid if any Cincinnati firefighter is laid off. As the city's newest firefighters shook hands with the manager and mayor, the uncertainty seemed to register on their faces. Loved ones were feeling it too, beaming with pride, but brimming with worry.
Obviously, there's a reason why we got the class. We need them around.
If there's a lasting frame to this day, it might very well be this message to families near the end.
We thank you for your sacrifices, your support, and your patience. We couldn't have done this without you, and we love you.
We have to make sure that these folks don't get sent home in the middle of the summer.
But 80 of them, in addition to those recruits, are on the bubble, as well as 189 police officers. Coming up at 6 tonight, the potential impact to citizen safety if those layoffs occur. Live at City Hall, John London, WLWT News. News 5.
All right, John, we will see you then. Now, we also want to take a closer look tonight at the city's Plan B. It details these staffing cuts across the board, saving the city almost $26 million. WLWT News 5's Brian Hamrick is showing us who's going to be taking a hit and what services and how many city pools are going away. Brian, we are talking about massive cuts here.
Cherie, the target is, it's a moving target, this whole thing. It's $35 million is what they're saying right now. It's not just fire and police jobs on the line. There are a number of others. It could even mean cuts to people who take care of baseball fields, for example, as they begin working on what they call Plan B.
The action playing out on these fields is hard to see, but impending cuts make this the bottom of the ninth for Plan A. In the bullpen.
Well, yesterday was the first day I directed the departments to begin to move Plan B into position.
City Manager Milton Dehoney says Plan B is all about cuts.
We don't have another cash and money just sitting there, so it'll be painful. Hopefully we won't have to do it, but we at least have to get ready in case we need to.
In addition to fire and police positions, among the cuts pinpointed so far are in the recreation department. It could be reduced by 10 to 15%. The jobs of outdoor maintenance crews are on the line, and after a dozen years of downsizing, administrators say there will be noticeable differences. The city's 120 baseball fields or so won't get the same attention, and trash collection will suffer at the parks too. Meanwhile, six city pools are being targeted to be shut down. Making a bigger splash, three rec centers will be closed. No details about which pools or rec centers are slated for the cuts, but for some who use the centers, it's not just about losing a place to play ball.
Maybe they have somewhere to look forward to if their home life is not so great, and so they have somewhere to escape to. So it's more than a recreation center.
A controversial proposal to lease parking would raise $92 million, more than enough to close the $35 million gap in the budget. But a judge ruled that the plan is eligible to go to a vote of the people. An appeal is already in the works, but for now, city finances are preparing for the squeeze play.
Now, if they make these cuts that they're talking about, they'll be effective no later than July 1st. That means some of these notifications will have to go out as early as the 1st of June. Reporting live, Brian Hamrick, WLWT News 5.
All right, Brian, thank you. The city is now expecting their appeal on the parking proposal ruling to be heard in about 3 or 4 weeks.
Putting the parking plan on the ballot, opponents to that plan are fanning out all across the city to gather support and signatures. Tonight, WLWT News 5's Jackie Conjato has the efforts to put the brakes on the plan to privatize city parking garages and meters.
Curtis, petitioners need 8,522 verified signatures by Friday to get the parking plan before voters in November. They know their ground game is important, and they know every signature counts. No one knows better that time is ticking, that the opportunity to get the parking plan before voters will expire on Friday. No one knows better than the folks spending their Saturday soliciting one signature at a time.
I was coming home and I saw the sign and I went, I have got to come around. I've got to come around and make sure I sign it.
About 8,500 valid verified signatures is what it'll take to put the city's plan to lease out the parking system up for a vote on the November ballot. The proposed 30-year lease would bring in $92 million up front and balance the city's budget for the next 2 years. But critics call it a sellout for a short-term fix.
It's a fire sale deal. They're in a budget hole. They need money. They're giving away an asset for very, very poor deal, and most people recognize it as that.
City Council passed the deal only for it to be struck down by a judge on Thursday. Almost immediately, the mayor defended it, explaining that revenue from the city's meters comes with limitations that this lease would eliminate.
We can only take that money and buy new parking meters and pay for garages and pave parking lots and things like that. We cannot use that money to operate. But under this parking lease arrangement, we could.
And without leasing parking, the city manager has said the only way to a balanced budget is through layoffs, hundreds of them to the city's police and fire forces. He's promised the pink slips are coming, but petitioners are still quick to call it a scare tactic.
I've had police and firemen off duty who live in the city have come and signed this morning, and they know it's hogwash.
We've asked repeatedly, and petitioners will not give us a number of signatures that they've collected so far, although they tell us that they want to get more than enough to make up for any that may not be valid. Reporting downtown, Jackie Conjato, WLWT News 5.
Today's big crowds for the game and that parade made for a perfect opportunity, though, for people also trying to stop Cincinnati's parking plan. And WLWT News 5's John London is live near the block party downtown, where more signatures for that petition are being gathered today. John?
Yeah, Cherie, they put signs on long poles to try to stand out in the crowd. There was one back here on Freedom Away a moment ago, but he's made his way down closer to the block party now. They already have more than 10,000 signatures, but as we saw today following council candidate Amy Murray around, you can't always tell that those signatures are legit.
With the clock ticking towards Friday.
Well, it should be a good day. I'm glad that they're out.
They're taking a swing at closing the deal on opening day.
Do you guys live in the city of Cincinnati?
Yeah, we do.
Critics like Amy Murray, who pound the parking plan as poorly conceived, are passing petitions around, proving you got to get plenty of pay.
They're not a city resident.
No, are you a city?
I'm Hamilton.
I'm Delhi.
Delhi, oh!
Sorry.
You must live within the city limits for your signature to count. 8,522 valid ones are required by the end of the week. They've crossed into five-figure territory, but probably need a two-to-one security net. Right after Alyssa Steinman's sign, I asked, what part of town?
Coleraine area.
Coleraine area?
Yep, right by the high school.
That's why signs were made a few hours ago for the baseball block party. Barron Printing will affix them to 10-foot poles to attract attention. Not only like-minded, but officially useful.
You know, lo and behold, they sign it and they actually live in Westchester. I think it's just, we don't need your mindset to be you live in the city of Cincinnati. We need you literally to be a registered voter in the city of Cincinnati.
Thank you so much.
Three young workers from the Hooters restaurant chain signed. So did this fella from Pleasant Ridge.
Don't know that it's a good idea. I don't know that it's a bad idea. I just don't like being rushed into it.
Warning of layoffs. The mayor and manager say by putting your John Hancock to it, you might as well be co-signing the pink slips of police and firefighters. Pat Studenka of Westwood doesn't buy it.
I think they got the priorities mixed up.
The meters, the money, mayoral campaign, and court case could be its own parade at this point. They're confident they'll have more than enough.
Here you go. Great. Thank you so much.
You're
I
welcome.
Appreciate it. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
All right. And sometimes there's not a whole lot of percentage out here at the St. Patrick's Day parade recently. They found that 90% of the people they approached were from outside the city of Cincinnati. To be on the safe side, they want about 15,000 or so signatures by the end of the week. Reporting live, John London, WLWT News 5.
All right, John London, thank you. So here's how this all works. If the petition drive falls short, the city's parking plan will go into effect. If it qualifies for the November ballot, the city is then going to file an immediate appeal.
Leading the way, on air, online, and on the go. WLWT News 5 at 5 starts now.
The fight over Cincinnati's parking plan starting to escalate tonight.
Yeah, the mayor now says that he is not just making threats this time when it comes to layoffs. WLWT News 5's John London live at the city at City Hall tonight, where Mayor Mallory wanted to set the record straight today just a few hours ago. John?
Yeah, Cherie, the mayor says he never meant that layoff line as a threat, simply a reflection of what he considers to be the reality of the situation. This comes as two council members have called for a special session this week to try to get a deeper understanding of that reality and how to change it. Cincinnati's mayor.
Some people think that I threatened them with laying off police officers and firefighters if this parking lease goes on the ballot.
Doing damage control today over his plea to citizens last week about not signing the parking petition. Those collecting signatures say the mayor's layoff scenario took on the ring of scare tactic and actually helped their ballot campaign. So today, five council Democrats joined his honor to say, look, we're not bluffing.
So I want to make sure that I reiterate the mayor's point that this is not a game.
Angrily at times, casting this as a game changer on growth, a mere month after the casino opened, and in the heady celebration of opening day at the banks.
Some have decided to stop the growth in its tracks.
over parking. Come on, folks.
The buzz, as critics circulate petitions, is that they'll have a pad of several thousand. They sense a certainty about ballot destiny. Merrill candidate John Cranley is pushing a slash plan that has no safety layoff component.
And I'm cutting the mayor's office, which will be my office. I'm cutting the council salaries. I'm cutting out the lobbyists. I'm cutting out the travel.
His main opponent, the current vice mayor, says leasing the parking assets will produce revenue and spur more growth. $92 million up front from these meters, as well as some garages and lots. They call it unlocking the potential. Even in their camp, though, there's hand-wringing.
Half of it is used to plug budget holes. I think that doesn't sit well with citizens. It doesn't sit well with me.
But as the signature deadline draws near, one of the mayor's major selling points is that the plan buys 2 years of budget time and assures continued growth.
Some people want to stifle that.
3 p.m. Thursday, that's when petitions will be turned in here, and an hour before that, a special session of council will explore the possibility of using casino revenue, among other things. Tonight at 6, someone who signed and says he now regrets it. Live at City Hall, John London, WWT News 5.
All right, John, we will see you then. Now, if enough ballot signatures are turned in, the city is going to appeal that. If it doesn't get a quick decision in its favor, the mayor says layoff notices will start going out May 1st.
With possible police and fire layoffs happening here, many of you out there are asking about the impact that we could see here in the future.
Yeah, and especially when handling large-scale events here in Cincinnati. WLWT News 5's Brian Hamrick went looking for answers for us tonight. Brian?
Yeah, Sheree, the Flying Pig Marathon is less than a month away. More than 30,000 runners and all tens of thousands of spectators. And when you see what happened in Boston, suddenly cuts that reduce police and firefighters take on a new meaning and add fuel to an already hot controversy. The Flying Pig Marathon. It's not the only big event in Cincinnati, but it's the next one that has so much in common with Boston. And it arrives as major police and fire cuts are on the line.
And then when you see something like what happened in Boston, when you see that kind of situation, it really, really draws additional concerns.
Cecil Thomas is head of Cincinnati's Public Safety Committee until his resignation takes effect tomorrow. He says first responders will overcome the reality of budget cuts.
Even with whatever staffing levels that we do have, I'm confident that law enforcement will step up.
The effort to lease parking to close a $35 million gap in the budget has been caught up in legal battles. Now, Cincinnati administrators are proposing the so-called Plan B. It calls for cuts that would leave an estimated 120 fewer firefighters and about 149 fewer police.
Certainly yesterday and other situations show the value that first responders bring to a community. If there was another way to deal with this, I would certainly choose it.
And I think they need to really think about reducing the staffing levels to the amounts that they're talking about, because it will not be safe for the citizens or for our officers.
FOP President Kathy Harrell says the time to rethink the plan is now.
When you start going to the amount of cuts that they're talking about, there are going to be people who are going to be injured, hurt, or possibly killed.
Now, the Plan B budget cuts wouldn't start until June, so staffing levels will be at the current level for this year's Flying Pig Marathon. Mike?
So tonight, frustrated firefighters talking to us about being on the chopping block.
Now, getting a look now at just how many jobs could be lost if Cincinnati shifts into budget Plan B. WLWT News 5's Laura Borcher is joining us live now with reaction tonight. Laura.
Mike and Sheree, Cincinnati was the first city with a full-time paid fire force. And tonight, fire union members say they're looking at taking such a leap backwards, they'll make history again. The word from City Hall tonight, 120 firefighters may be laid off. The union says that means 40% of Cincinnati firehouses could close.
It's one of our busiest houses in the city of Cincinnati.
And it sits across the street from the new casino. But the fire protection this 8th Street firehouse provides may soon be cut in half. And the firehouse that backs it up may be completely shut down. It highlights just how painful these cuts would be. Firefighters say heat is turning up down at City Hall. They've seen layoff letters go out in other years without losing manpower. But this year, the shortfall is $35 million.
We're like any other Cincinnatians. We don't know. We're being told. It's bad, you know, it's worst case scenario.
Plan A was the parking deal. This is Plan B, laying off 120 Cincinnati firefighters along with more police officers. Union President Matt Alter says the new cuts would trim 13 to 16 fire companies.
Everybody's on the table. Every firehouse and every company in the city of Cincinnati is on the table.
With companies closed, you could wait longer in an emergency, and medics say time is tissue. Every second counts when you're saving lives. Firefighters say every 30 to 60 seconds a fire doubles. So we ask, would you be safe working in a high rise or living in a downtown apartment?
They're going to give it their all. And I hope that giving it their all, we hope that whatever it is, whatever they're giving their all is enough. And should these cuts go through? No, they won't be safe.
And I have the early list of firehouses being considered to be shut down. They do include the houses in the Gaslight District, Hyde Park, OTR, and Sedamsville. We're told the plan is still fluid and numbers, as we've seen in the past, may change. I'm Laura Borchers. Back to you guys.
You know, people are just furious about the mayor's pay raises to his own staffers. The FOP is saying that its Facebook page now filled with officers venting about it, since police and firefighters could be getting laid off any day now. WLWT News 5's John London tried to talk with the mayor about this today. He joins us live at City Hall. John?
Well, the mayor was not around and he was not available, we were told. His justification for the raises contained in a memo here to Budget Director Leah Erickson, saying the net result is a reduced office budget, but I tell you, it's not resonating tonight with the rank and file.
Calling it a slap in the face.
I think anger, frustration, disgust, I think that's putting it mildly.
The head of Local 48 says firefighters are livid about Mayor Mark Mallory's decision to give pay raises to his staffers while the city contemplates police and fire layoffs.
What am I supposed to tell the firefighters now? How do I explain to the firefighters and paramedics?
As many as 120 of them could be laid off in a few weeks. Police are also staring at deep job cuts. In a memo to the budget director, the mayor says he's actually cutting his office budget, producing a savings of 66 grand. He's giving raises ranging from 11 to 20% to four of his remaining staffers who will be job hunting this fall. But the raises throw more heat into a mayoral race that's already a furnace.
We would all hope that people would turn back those, all of the savings.
They are out of touch.
Candidate John Cranley says Vice Mayor Roxanne Falls should make a motion to repeal the raises.
Cops and firefighters are simply more important than staffers in the mayor's office or the council office.
The money Mayor Mallory is using comes from within his existing budget. But as the manager works to minimize layoffs and still close a $35 million gap, timing and image produce a perfect political storm.
He only took money that he was already spending and took some of it to give to these people. But the reality simply is the public doesn't see it that way.
Fire department leaders huddle again tomorrow to measure the impact of layoffs on response time. The police chief told us yesterday the prospect of layoffs is uppermost on his mind. So far, the Dyer Dohoney diagram of cuts has no workable substitute.
If we're stuck with this plan B, what the mayor did is a blip on the radar screen. I mean, it means nothing.
Now, in strict dollars and cents terms, the raises add up to just over $39,000. There are at least three firefighters in the city who make under that amount. As we were parked at this very spot a few hours ago, a police officer slowed, rolled down his window, and asked incredulously, double-digit raises? Live at City Hall, John London, WLWT News 5.
And by the way, it has been 3 years since police officers got a raise. That was 2%. Taking back raises after people raised a stink.
And with police and fire cuts just around the corner, Mayor Mallory rescinded those controversial pay bumps to people in his office. WLWT News 5's Curtis Fuller has more from City Hall.
You've got to show the citizens what your priorities are.
That message from Police Union President Kathy Harrell to Mayor Mark Mallory after he released this statement saying, "I am rescinding the raises I gave my staff and returning all salaries to the previous levels."
Is it a surprise to me that he actually rescinded them? Yes. But the bottom line is it's called damage control.
The mayor had given raises ranging from 11% to 20% to four members of his staff. In a memo, he told the city's budget director changes he made in his office structure would actually save $66,000.
It was definitely a slap in the face to firefighters. We certainly are appreciative that he realized that this probably was terrible timing and not the thing to do.
In rescinding the raises, the mayor said the perception has had a negative effect on the morale of other city employees.
He called me and explained to me, hey, this is the reason why I did this. He said, it looks bad. He goes, I know that. And I think he realized how bad it looked, and I'm glad that he reversed it.
300-plus city workers, most of them fire and police, are facing layoffs. This from Firefighters Union President Matt Alter.
You know, we hope that others may take this as an example and follow his lead and sharpening pencils and realizing that now is not the time to be doing things like this.
Now, out live tonight, the mayor's action may have cooled some of the anger and frustration felt by city employees facing possible job cuts. And again, those job cuts, the big concern tonight, lingering over the city. In fact, the local union president for the firefighters said right now the threat of those job cuts is more real than ever before. Reporting live, I'm Curtis Fuller, WLWT News 5.
Thank you, Curtis. Mayor Mallory's staff members will not have to give back what they've already been paid, though salary reversal does take effect, though, immediately.
You know, the city of Cincinnati is facing a serious budget crunch. We've been telling you all about it. Well, now officials are talking about laying off hundreds of workers.
But is that the best way to go? Now, we poured over the salaries of all of Cincinnati's employees. WLWT News 5's Amy Wagner shows us who is really making the big bucks.
We just want to serve and protect and do it with support.
Kyle Strunk is one of Cincinnati's finest. With 7.5 years under his belt, he's all too aware his belt, taser, and gun could soon be stripped from him and nearly 150 other officers.
You know, these aren't cops who've been on 6 months. We know the streets. We know our jobs well. We know the people.
Also on the chopping block, firefighters, the latest class of graduates, and more than 80 already on the job. Cincinnati city manager says he doesn't know any other option.
If there was another way to deal with this, I would certainly choose it.
Milton Dehoney is the man behind the plan to balance the budget. He says a massive layoff is the only option. Others disagree.
I know that there are other options. The money is there.
You know, when I lay out the math and lay out the numbers, I don't think we need to be gutting our safety forces.
WLWT News 5 focused a months-long investigation on the city's $338 million payroll for 2012, which is about 25% of the city's total budget. The top 25 earners on that list make more than $150,000 each for a combined $4.6 million, which equals the salaries of 73 police officers.
If we do need to make cuts, let's start with the supervisors, the middle management, where things are a little bit bloated and where some of those highest salaries are. Let's not start with, you know, the cop on the beat, the firefighter who's being dispatched to save lives.
In the city manager's department, 8 employees make a combined $1.2 million, the equivalent of 25 firefighters. And Dehoney himself commands the highest pay in the city, close to $300,000 after city council approved a raise last year. His paycheck equals that of more than 6 firefighters.
Part of the reason why I was one of the votes against him getting what felt like a pretty lavish raise had less to do with him and more to do with the broader economic circumstance. We are very short of money.
When you look around the country for people that do what I do for a living, there are plenty of city managers who make a lot more than I make.
But after examining more than a dozen cities of comparable size, our research put Dehoney's paycheck at the top of the list for city managers.
It's arguably an issue for people, and I do understand that. But it is a salary that my bosses have chosen to give me.
A major issue for Kathy Harrell and the officers she represents.
He gets the salary that he gets, and it's like a slap in the face to all the city employees who have constantly either had to give back days, take furlough days.
And now face layoffs. Considering the paychecks at the top, it's a tough pill for some to swallow.
There's a hierarchy of needs, and police and fire would be the last thing to do. And I'm pretty much convinced we don't need to go there.
I don't think anyone can have an understanding of what it's like to work in a job where consistently being told you might not have a job come this date.
And while Dahoney says he can't fathom a plan that could save jobs and still close that $35 million plus deficit, Sittenfeld points to casino revenue, a rainy day fund, and the city's current parking system as possible sources of revenue. He also questions the city's bloated travel budget, something we have already begun to investigate. Mike and Cherie.
Amy, thank you. Very interesting. If you want to see exactly how much the city's top earners are making, it's just a click away. We posted the salary information for every city employee right on our website, WLWT.com.